I want to make an announcement for people to scoot, because it is packed.
Okay, we're going to every room.
Good evening. Good. Check, check. Good evening. Really quickly, if we could have everybody scoot toward the center, try to huddle up, get to know people pretty well. As you can tell, we're pretty crowded. We just want to make room for more people as they come in. So if everybody could scoot toward the center aisle, thank you so much.
Good evening. Hello. I'm Joe Green. I'm the lead pastor here at First Broad Street. And welcome. Could we do this again Sunday? Remember where you're sitting. And I tell you, I knew that word leaked out that we weren't taking up an offering tonight, and here you are. But welcome. We're so glad you're here. For some people, this is the first time you've been this close to the front. And this is what it looks like up close. But we're glad you're here. Tonight, the Lord is in this place. And tonight, we're going to have an experience with Jesus. And that's why we're here. And that's why we're here together. And I know that you're closer to the person next to you than you ever dreamed you would be when you first came in. That's okay. That's okay, because this is a special night. So let's pray together. Father God, our hearts overflow. And Lord, we just pray tonight that you'd pour out your spirit upon each one. And let us, Lord, may each of us see Jesus tonight. We open our hearts to you. We come into this place with great expectation for an encounter with you. So Lord, as you bless us together with the church. Be in our midst, Father. And again, we praise you. We thank you for this week as we make our way to the cross and beyond to an empty grave. May that celebration already be stirring our hearts as we gather in the name above every name, the name of Jesus. Amen.
Good evening, and welcome to this Maundy Thursday service, to this service of the Living Last Supper. On this night, we reflect and remember the events of that night long ago, when Jesus ate with his disciples one final meal, when by one of his own disciples he was betrayed, and when he was arrested. one by one, the disciples abandoned him to death. The scene you will witness tonight is not a fully historical account. We do not know all the disciples, who they were beyond a name, and sometimes those names do not agree between the Gospels. Others, such as Peter and Thomas and Judas, we know very well. The story presented tonight is the story of the 12, pieced together from Scripture, from history, and from the tradition that has been handed down from the beginning of the church. We will hear from each of the disciples. Following their stories, we will share in Holy Communion. Let us listen to their story, and in it we might find our story, the story of our relationship with Christ. For our own story speaks of trust and devotion, as well as desertion and despair, betrayal and denial. Yet through it all, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it.
He asked if he could sit in my boat, and I rowed him out so that his voice may carry for all to hear. I did as he asked. After he was done preaching, he asked if I would row out further and cast my nets again into the water. I was annoyed and frustrated because I told him it was pointless. We had been fishing all night, and we hadn't caught anything. And then suddenly, so many fish. So many fish that our nets began to break while we were trying to pull them onto our two boats. So many fish that both of our boats began to sink under the weight of all that we caught. I fell to my knees, feeling ashamed, sinful, and faithless in his presence. He then told me that I would no longer catch fish, but I would catch men. I didn't fully understand what he meant, but I left everything. I left my fish, my boats, my livelihood. Left everything to follow him, and I've never looked back. And now tonight, as we gather, he tells us that one of us will betray him, one of the 12 disciples, one of his best and closest friends. I vainly promised to follow him anywhere, even to death, but he looked me in the eye tonight and said, before the rooster crows, I will deny him three times. Deny him to me. Am I not the rock that he called me to be? Am I not faithful, strong enough? Lord, is it I?
I've been known as Peter's little brother, Andrew, since the day I was born. Years ago, I left the fishing business to follow the fiery preacher, John the Baptist. He was anointed by God to prepare the way for the Messiah, and now I follow him. I love to bring people to Jesus. I brought my brother to Jesus, and I've seen him do great works. I brought the little boy with the 5 loaves and 2 fish. I've even brought Gentiles to meet the Master. He's willing to meet anyone who's willing to seek the truth. But Jesus has enemies in high places, enemies that plan to silence him and to kill him. He speaks of a betrayer in our midst. But please, Lord, please do not let him be. Jesus, is it I?
I am James the Lesser, known as such to describe my stature and to differentiate me from the many other men who are named James. Since joining Jesus' group, I've seen many miraculous things. Jesus has the power to calm the seas. Even the wind and the rain obey his voice. He can cast out demons. I've seen him cast out evil spirits. And he told us we could do the same in his name. And now, one of us is going to betray him. One of these men sitting at this table, one who eats and drinks with him, one who would doubt that he is the Messiah. He called each of us to follow. How could anyone doubt? Is it I?
Calls us sons of thunder. Actually, we were sons of Zebedee. My father is a very rich and powerful man in the community, even a personal friend of many of the influential religious leaders. And at one time, I had hoped that would assure me a position of power in the new kingdom. In fact, it was my mother who suggested that I should sit at Jesus' right hand when he claimed his throne, and John at his left. After all, it was we who were invited to the mountain with Jesus, where we saw him changed, transfigured. His face shone like the sun. The voice of God spoken out of heaven. He chose me. He chose each of us. How could any of us betray him? We've seen his perfect adherence to the law. We've seen him perform miracles, healings, works that no mere man could accomplish. We have heard God say, "This is my son." Could it be my brother, John? Could it be me? Is it I?
I am Matthew. Before becoming a disciple of Jesus, I collected taxes as a worker in the Roman government. I used to take advantage of one of the perks of this profession, skimming a little off the top for my personal use. Listening to Jesus, I came to realize I was sinning against my neighbors. I took advantage of those people. I cheated them. I stole from them and became wealthy from their hard-earned goods and wages. I was hoarding earthly treasures instead of seeking eternal ones. But my heart's changed because of Jesus. I've even thrown a big feast at my house and invited others, including those who I worked alongside in the government and who worked corruptly alongside me, hoping that they could meet Jesus like I did and perhaps be changed as well. But now Jesus speaks of a traitor. Will the others begin to think it's me, a publican, a known sinner? Lord, is it I?
Before I was called by Jesus, I was a member of the Zealots. We believe in God, and that God alone ruled over the nation of Israel. And we refuse to pay homage or taxes to any Roman government. It goes against my nature, but Jesus taught that God ordained all powers and governments to rule over us, and that we should show them our respect and pay them our due. Since following Jesus, I've been trying to channel my zeal to share God's word and to share about Jesus and reach all of the people of his kingdom. Is there a spy among us? A Roman, perhaps?
Could I revert back to my old ways? Could I, Simon, betray my king? Is it I?
We have celebrated the Feast of Passover for thousands of years.
remembering the slavery with the bitter herbs, remembering the plague with 10 drops from the goblet, remembering how the blood of the sacrificed lamb caused the angel to pass over the Israelites and spare their firstborn. How God set his people free. What a wonderful story. How they left in such haste without time to bake leavened bread. And they baked unleavened bread in the warmth of the sun. Now Jesus breaks this unleavened bread and says, "This is my body." He shares the cup and says, "This is my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." I don't understand. What could make me betray my friend? Lord, is it I?
My name is Philip. Jesus came to me one day when I was working and said simply, "Follow me." I spent the entire day with him, and I was convinced this truly is the promised one. It has taken some time for me to realize that this man, this fulfilled promise, is actually God here among us. Recently, thousands of men, women, families were seated on the mountain listening to him teach. Jesus asked me, "Where are we going to find money to buy bread for the people?" Immediately, I thought only of the actual physical cost. Why, our treasury has no such funds. I gave no thought to the comfort of the people or the possibility of a divine miracle. But Jesus took 5 tiny loaves of bread, 2 tiny fish, prayed over them, broke them into pieces, and fed thousands. We picked up 12 baskets full of leftovers. God, here among us. How could anyone deny the promised one, this divine presence with us? And to whom would such a person take him? To the vain and arrogant priests who refused to believe God kept his promise? Or to the pagan Roman government, afraid of a rival ruler? Could any one of us forget his power, his compassion? Could I forget? Is it I?
His hands are carpenter's hands. You've seen them before, they're rough, weathered. But if you look closely, you'll see that they're loving and gentle. His hands have touched a leper and the disease erased from his body. His hands reached out and touched Peter's mother-in-law. Her fever disappeared. His hands reached down and lifted Jairus' daughter from her own deathbed. His hands shone all of us love and mercy. His hands have shown us kindness and healing. His hands have served me, Thaddeus, and the brothers, and worship the Lord above. His hands, so loving, so kind, but yet, one of us, who would betray us? Who could betray him and place him in the hands of an enemy? We have all received blessings from his hands. We have all seen the miracles that his hands have done for all of us, our brothers, But yet, who will deny him? Will I, Thaddeus, betray you? Is it I, Lord? Is it I?
Beloved, loved by Jesus, the one who was there in the beginning with God, the one who is greater than all of us, and yet he washed my feet. Now, you might think that because I'm the beloved disciple, that I have a reason to be proud, that I might enjoy some heavenly power or prestige. But no, he has shown me over and over that the war he wages is a spiritual one. Jesus calls out to the needy, the paupers. He is not entertained by the elite, by the powerful. He dines in the homes of the common folk, the regular guy. I have seen him equally befriend a well-known Pharisee and an immoral woman, forgiving both. God sent his son because he loved the world, the lowly, needy. This Jesus, he is the way, the truth, and the life. Now, even though we are his closest friends, his closest followers, we do not understand the depth of his love, that he, being greater than I, would die for me? How could I not do the same? How could I not do the same? Will it be my pride that causes me to stumble? Could I betray him? Is it I?
I've been listening to Jesus talk tonight around the table. I just don't get it. Words meant to comfort, leading to confusion and misunderstanding. Talk of betrayal only met with incredulity and fear. Where is it going? There's so much that needs to be done right here, right now. Sometimes I'm amazed that I, Thomas, have seen him with my own eyes. I've touched my Lord and Master with my own hands. I've watched him perform wonders, change the lives of everyone around him. I don't want him to go. How are we supposed to follow him if we don't know where he is going? Could there be something that I've done or will do that will lead to this betrayal that he's speaking of? Could it be that he's seen inside my heart of hearts, my lack of faith, my doubts, and my fear? Is it I?
I'm Judas Iscariot. I too am a follower of Jesus. I have followed him from the beginning. I believe he is the Messiah. But why would God send a Messiah for this? Someone who serves bread, someone who washes feet. I have no need for a spiritual king. This man has crowds follow him over mountains. They follow him across rivers. If he wanted to, he could have an army. He could free us. He could free us from this Roman oppression. But he says, love your enemy. I will not. Look at everybody around here. They look like sheep without a shepherd. They right now are asking themselves, who betrayed them? They are searching their hearts. They are looking inwardly. Well, someone has betrayed them. History will remember me for this. History will thank me for this. Tonight, the chief elders and the priests will help me make Jesus make his move to usher in his kingdom. Spiritually. My Lord, is it I?
I've been looking forward to sharing this Passover meal with you before I go to supper. I tell you that this is the last I shall eat until we gather together to eat once more in God's kingdom. This is my body, given for you. Take and eat. And remember me. This is the cup of the new covenant written with my blood poured out for you.